When Steel Talks, everybody listen.
When Steel Talks is very pleased to have at Basement Studios Mr. Scipio Sargeant, also known as Skip Sargeant. Very nice to have you. Also known as Sarge. Very good to have you here.
I'm glad to be here.
Ah, so tell us a bit about yourself. You are a musician extraordinaire. You are an arranger. You're well known on the New York pan scene, and you made your musical mark years before that. So tell us the man behind the name.
Well, I've been playing for a long time. At an early age, from 8, 9 years old, my family was into music. My bigger brother that everybody knows, Les Sargeant, who's played Fitzmaugham Brian, he's the one responsible for that Tan Tan thing, that big hit. And so at an early age I started playing, and I was one of the fortunate ones to play in some of the best bands as a teenager in Trinidad. So that's where most people know me. You know, I played with the Sparrows and the Kitcheners when I was like 16 and 17. Mm. When I was 17 I arranged for Despers in Trinidad. You know, and when I was 20 I came to New York.
Mm-hmm. And what was your main instrument at the time when you played with the bands back home?
My instrument was always a guitar. Mm. I used to play a little pan one time, and it was really a little pan. And I played bass, but arrangement came to me at an early age. So while I was working on the guitar, I was also arranging. You know, I guess from a lot of practice, I ended up being an arranger. It wasn't something I was looking for. I always wanted to be the best guitar player in the world. And over the years, you realize I could only be the best guitar player I can be. They were doing that in the world, it's up to them. Mm-hmm. But the arranging with the band, it wasn't something I was looking forward to. You know, I had other dreams other than.
So how did you?
Well, I was in England and it was quite successful for 4 years.
Arranging for pan?
No, doing dance music.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, I had several big club hits in Europe. Massive. You know, I still get royalties from that.
That's good.
But when I came back here in 92, I ran into Denzel Botas. And he was there in 67. I used to arrange for Despers in Trinidad. And he told me he was working on a project with Despers and if I could come and lend some assistance. And that's how I got into the band thing all over again. And it's been pretty good. You know. Now I'm into it because I think that the band needs to be heard in a better way. You know, it needs to reach to the point where other music has reached over the years. The old stigma of pan, you know, like you have to be a badger to play pan. No, you know, still have people that think that way. You know. My thing is that I think pan is an instrument. Whether it's in a steel band or it's in an orchestra, things like that. So what I'm trying to do with the pan is to make the pan play the same thing the violins play.
Yeah. In Trinidad, when you arranged with Desperados, mm-hmm. How many years was that for? 1 year? 2 years? You said it's 17.
1 year, and they had a lot of success from that 1 year.
What was that experience like? At so young an age?
Well, in experiences, that was really tough because they had another arranger. They had called in Beverly Griffith, who used to arrange for them before. Mm-hmm. I'd come to America. And they tried Ron Berridge, who I was playing with at that time, and he was the top band at that time. And Roy Keith is responsible for all of this. He said it wasn't working out with Ron Berridge for some reason. And he said, you need to call Les Sargeant, little brother. He could do it. And they called me, and in 4 weeks they had the Panorama sound, the bomb, which is the classic, mm-hmm. and they had an extra sound, which was 67, a Kitchener sound. And they came second, that Panorama. Stories that it came second because they won the year before, so they couldn't keep winning. However, it was quite good. The classic that I did won the music festival a couple months later, so that's why I say it was something. But I left the next year
because your heart wasn't in pan at that moment. He's pan arranging.
It wasn't that my heart wasn't into it. There was an opportunity to come to America.
Okay.
It wasn't for the reasons people leave Trinidad. People usually leave the islands to come to America because it's, you know, it's the country where you can come and become something that you can become in the Caribbean or whatever. But while I was in Trinidad, I was doing what I wanted to do at a high level. So I came because there was an opportunity to come here.
This was at age 20?
Yes, I'm there. And it's been a hell of an experience coming here too, you know, but it's been cool.
You've had major musical experiences. You mentioned Wes Montgomery.
Yeah, I never met him. The one opportunity I had to meet Wes Montgomery, I had a gig tonight, and I had tickets, and I took the gig. I think he died that night or something, or the next week or something. But when I was in Trinidad, for some reason I was really impressed with Wes playing. So I was buying records for like $40 as a teenager to hear Wes Montgomery play. And I would listen to it for weeks and months, and I couldn't figure out nothing. I thought he was playing the guitar upside down. Because I would learn the song that he was playing, and I would try to figure out what he was playing. And I was already very knowledgeable about chords and things, because I was kind of fortunate to have one of my father friends teach me all these old standards when I was like 13 and 14. So when I was 17, there was some experience behind playing jazz and stuff, you know. So he was one of my main influences. I mean, there's a lot of different guitar players that I listen to.
Tell us about some
of them. Barney Kessel, Jim Hall, Charlie Christian, you know, that's just to name a few. Todd Fallow. I used to listen to a lot of guitar players. There's a few good ones in Trinidad too. My bigger brother was a big influence. You know, I don't know how he did it. Because when we talk about it today, he said he didn't know a quarter what I know today. But he used to play 100%. Not a quarter, he used to play 100%. But I was fortunate in the sense that I was tall, I was 10, 11 years old. I used to get to go to all these big dances in Trinidad where everybody had to be like over 18 and 20 to be in these dances. So people used to think I was like an older guy and thing, but I was really just 10 and 11. So I used to get to go and hear my brother play every weekend.
So being the experience.
Yeah, something rubs off our feel. And there's some good musicians that came out of Trinidad also, you know. So it was quite influential for me.
So when you arranged the first time, and well, actually what was probably the only time for Desperados in 67, you brought your own experiences to the table for arranging
because
at that point.
Yeah, the band to me was like notes. It wasn't first band, second band, guitar band, all the different million bands. It was to me, it was like an opportunity to arrange for a band side I did from the guitar, which I continue to do today. I don't play steel drums. I have air freight. If I sit down with a steel drum in 5 minutes, I'll pick out a song because I already know the music, but I don't play saxophone either, and I've been writing for saxophone players for years, you know. I started in Fari Belafonte, he made me write for the drummer. I don't play drums. So I think that if you know music, you could put it on any instrument.
You've worked with a lot of people here in the U.S. Tell us about some of those experiences. We know about Despers USA, and we'll get to that in a few minutes. But well, you've also worked on the quote-unquote pop scene, the soul scene.
Yeah, I've been involved in quite a few things with other different people. Joe Tex, I think when he died, I wrote the horns. The wife found me in New York, and they want me to write some horns. I've been around the city with George Benson in the early days before he came famous. As a matter of fact, his cousin brought him to hear me play guitar. So he thought I was the greatest thing in the world. And so we became good friends. You know, I've been around with Ashford and Simpson. My thing wasn't really to play with big name bands because I wasn't playing jazz. So I was going through a phase where I was getting the offers as a good guitar player. You know, Melvin Moore, you know, guys that used to play with me used to play with Melvin Moore, so they called me for the gig. I turned down the gig and I just continued turning down the gigs. And, but I did a lot of writing and producing here, and never had a major hit, but I had songs that played all over the country. Because it was independent productions, you know. Sometimes we played at BLS you kind of supply the stores with records, or it was like that, you know. But as a jazz musician, you never really even think about things like recording. All you always think about is getting that guitar together.
And jazz is your main influence, that's where your love is?
Yes, and it's a different kind of jazz too, because over the years, I tried to play like George Benson and Les McGrammy.
Wait, Jim, so hang on, you trying to play like George Benson?
Well, I mean, who came to hear me?
Exactly, I found it interesting that, you know, he was brought to hear you.
Yeah, but I can explain that. He was born here. I was born in Trinidad. So when he heard me play, he didn't know guys from Trinidad could play like that. So I told him we listen to the same people. And that's all it is. But he's awesome. He's really good. But I have people that think I'm that good. I don't think about how good I am. When I go and play, that's me. So, but I think the style that George Benson played is pretty close to what I do. The difference is I was born in Trinidad, and over the years of trying to be an Americanized guitar player, I found out you could be also a good Caribbean guitar player that plays jazz with the different colors. You know, they don't play reggae and samba and Latin and cha-cha-cha and all these things that we grew up hearing. So in trying to become an American guitar player, meaning the style, I realized I could do the same thing with the Caribbean music.
You have had an affiliation with Denzel Bogus.
Yeah.
Also known as Belt.
He's the one who got me involved in this desperado situation from last
night. Despers USA for the...
Yeah, because he was playing double second when I did Despers in 67. Mm-hmm. Robert Greenwich was there, mm-hmm. You know. Robert was the one with the translate. You know, I would play the parts and then he would take it and go to the tenor mm-hmm. and things like that. So I was in England from 88 to 92. When I came back, I met Denzel, I think it was a year later. And he was doing something for Despers, and he said, I need you. You need to come up here. And so I went up there, and I just started arranging. I don't know if I wanted to do it, I didn't want to do it. I was there, and I started doing it, and then they won, and then that led to next year. And
6 years in succession.
9 years. It's 6 years for them because they had won the year before I came. Mm-hmm. Then I won 5 years straight. And then we had some seconds and thirds and, you know, different
things. So you have a 9-year historical affiliation with the Despers USA.
Yeah,
and you can say five of those, the first five were consecutive wins.
Yeah, they were all good years. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I thought that I brought something different to the steel band. Being that I don't play steel drums, mm-hmm. You see? Guys that play steel drums have a tendency to think like a steel drum player, whatever that is. I consider myself a music person. So it's inclusive of everything. All what I think I am is what I bring to the steel drum, you know?
The pan scene, quote-unquote, in New York, what are your thoughts on that at the moment?
We'll have to do that in two parts. We'll do the first part today. My thoughts on the pan scene is that... I feel it's going nowhere fast.
Because you're thinking of pan as an instrument that needs to be on the world stage, and so there are several situations here.
Well, on the world stage, don't get me wrong now, the world have pan all over. Australia, Germany, France, you name it, there's steel drum bands. It's an instrument. And with the internet and all the different things that they have nowadays, everybody knows everything. People there's no more dark ages. It's in your mind now. Everybody knows about everything. In India, you probably have steel band, one guy playing a steel drum. The traditional steel drum band that we're accustomed to in Trinidad is... It's a little difficult to pull that one off in America because in Trinidad it's like you have all these corporations that sponsor these bands, and you know, for those bands to function here they would need sponsors. They need a home, you're talking about 100 players. And if they all have 9-to-5s, then they only have a couple hours in the evening to have the band, you see. So these bands need to be housed, they need to have, and the band players need to be musically educated because this is America. Some of them are, and some of them just.
So you're saying that music theory should be part of their.
Well, I think the more you know, if he was going to a doctor and he didn't, and he said told you that he only had 6 weeks practice, you would be taking him to a psychiatrist. So I figured, and that's how I think. So I figured if you're going to do music, you should know something about music. You know, it makes it easier for the arranger, and it makes it better for the band. It makes you feel better too that you're talking about something that you know about. You know, so I think what's best for band players or musicians, you know, is to know something about what you're dealing with.
The young people who you work with, for say in Despers USA, what kind of impact do you have on them? I mean, do you share your experiences with them? What kind of talent base do you see coming up?
Well, the kids that I work with love me because I have that charismatic thing that makes them feel at home. Mm-hmm. But there's some other kids who used to play the Desperados that I teach. I've been teaching them for like 5 years. The kids of a friend of mine named Edgar Fitzgerald, they call them Spots, he used to play the Highlanders. And the youngest one is now 15, and last year he won his college scholarship. I've been teaching him for 5 years. And the two bigger cousins, I think they're about 18, one plays keyboard, one plays bass, they all read. And they're starting to compose and sequence, they're in college, they're A students. And I've been teaching them for like 5.5 years. I would like to do that with other kids. But you have to find the right situation, you know. And these kids that I taught, I mean, I've been teaching for years, since in Trinidad, you know. For some reason, things had worked out where, for me in Trinidad, what little I know, somebody needed to know some of it, so I used to teach. There was one guy who used to come from the country. He used to bring me yams and oranges and things to learn little chords and the guitar. And I was probably 14 or 15 at that time. So I was always fortunate to pass on the knowledge. And most of the musicians that pass through New York know me in some way. Teaching, helping, and something like that. But with kids, the kids need to know more. I wish there could be an institution where I could really pass on the knowledge that I have. Because I really never went to school for music. But I read a lot of books and I played a lot of years, and that's the big school. To me, going to school, these are small schools, you know. You go to Brooklyn College to go to school for music, I wouldn't get what I have today.
Experience is also a great teacher.
Well, definitely. And being aware of it even makes it better for you. You know, I didn't know this was going to happen. I used to think I told you about Wes Montgomery. We played with Wes. I listened to his records for years and I couldn't figure out what he was playing. And then after a while, I would play some of it. Not from working it out, I could never get it. Because it was kind of a little above my head. But I would go on a gig and I would play something and I'd say, oh yeah, I heard that. I heard that somewhere, you know? And then you have to figure it and dissect it and figure, well, where did this come from? How do you fit this here and that? So experience is a great teacher. And when you teach people from that experience, you become a better player.
Reinforces.
Definitely, because you see, when you teach people, you have to make sure you're doing the right thing. You know what I'm saying? Where I might have been getting away with a couple sloppy licks. When I'm teaching to someone, I have to take my time and play the right lick. So then I know it also. You know, so the teaching thing is good. The influence in Despers, I also did some music for sonatas. That was a couple of years ago. That was a great experience too. But as far as the future of Pan, I think it needs to be organized. If they want to do the traditional thing of having these big steel drum bands, it needs to be organized. This is America. And everything is organized. Mm-hmm. Well, people is the only thing that's not organized, actually. But if you have a group, that needs to be organized and treated professionally. You know, it's a professional thing. Everything's professional. I'm a simple person, so I usually associate one thing with another. You know, I think about a heart surgeon. You want the best heart surgeon, you want the best arranger, you want the best band player. You know, So that's what I think.
You have recently released a CD album. What is the name of it?
Strings and Things.
Strings and Things. Is this your first release?
No, I did an album last year called Journey. And I was in California, like you can see, and I was thinking of doing a Christmas album. I was thinking that, you know, I've heard so many different Christmas albums, and I was thinking of doing one with strings and things mean instruments, vocals, steel drums, and of course, playing some guitar. Yeah.
Just been handed a copy of it here. Yeah. It's Christmas.
Yeah, it's Christmas. It makes it feel like Christmas, though.
Edgar Fitzgerald, and you mentioned him. He's the father of the kids that you toured for a few years, right?
They played on one song.
Eber's here, yeah. Touring.
Yeah, Curran, that's the, he's the tenor player. He's awesome. He's 15 years old, going on 60. I told him one time, I said, you're the only kid can listen to my conversations. Because he's an old musician. They're good. I really feel happy about teaching kids music. There's something that I have in me that I can relate to them. I know how to relate to them. You put two kids in a room and I give them an instrument, they play a song in 15 minutes. I'll make them play. Even if they never play it, I'll make them play something 15. I mean, some songs are really simple, it could be two notes. But that is not a magic, it's just that it's a determination. It's the same thing with Pan, you know, when I reach arranging for Pan, so I remember he's a carpenter and he plays steel drums for Panorama. So he's rusty, he's not a band player that plays every day. So you sit with them and get them to focus on what you're doing. And I don't leave until they play the part. So that works. So if you have kids, it's easier. Kids seem to pick up real quick.
What type of audience are you aiming for? Because you are internationally based. So with your Strings and Things Christmas CD album, did you have a particular audience in mind?
No, because there's one song on the album that I wrote called Christmas Day. It says everything. It says when you touch someone, to them it's Christmas Day. You know, it means if someone down and out and you do something for them, they feel good. So that's why I said every day should be like Christmas Day. Christmas, I don't know if you belong to some religious country that don't celebrate Christmas. Christmas is Christmas. So I figure since the whole world is connected now, this wasn't geared for any particular audience. Anybody can listen to it.
That's good.
You know, that's what I really think. It's a nice album. It's a little bit interesting.
Oh, well, I'll be taking a listen to it, and we shall expect to be hearing great things about this.
Well, I hope so.
Hope it's going to become an annual favorite.
Well, that's what we look for. But it's a good album based on, you know, what I try to do is, when I'm arranging music, I don't think about markets. And, you know, if I'm arranging for someone, I think about that. They say, oh, it'll be too reggae from songs, too R&B songs, disco songs, whatever. When I'm doing music, I think about how I feel about music and life. So whether it's commercial or it's not commercial, and these are just words that people use, you know, that really doesn't mean anything.
So it becomes a personal experience then?
It's always a personal experience.
That you put out there.
Yeah. You know, and I'll tell you something, a couple of years ago, I stopped criticizing other people's music. Well, we all criticize, we're all human. Because when somebody makes an effort, it's better than somebody that didn't make an effort. I did that very serious. So even though it's just an album, you know, it put people from different countries together. A few people like different things. You know,
it's pretty true.
Yeah. It's just music. You know, music, I look at music and life and everything pretty much the same way. You know, you've got to be spiritual with yourself. And do what you think you want to do, because you can live and die, rich or poor, it doesn't make no difference.
What do you want to touch on? Desperados in Trinidad, and you arranged for them at age 17. Mm-hmm. What was your personal experience with Rudolph Charles?
When you mention the word Rudolph Charles, or the name Rudolph Charles, sent chills through my body. Rudolph Charles resembled my father for some reason. So there was always something about Rudolph, like if, I mean he's older than I am, but there was always some sort of father figure, Rudolph. He took care of me, you know. I was this young arranger and nobody never treated me like that before, you know, like I was a king. They used to come and take me out of my bed. I used to grab the toothbrush and wash my mouth as I leave and take me up the hill and he's telling all these guys, what does Sarge want for breakfast? And in another couple of hours it was like, what he wants for lunch? And I used to arrange for like a stage out of 10 people. And of course I was playing with Clarence the Beverage at that time, so I'm busy playing and stuff like that. And one night a friend took me to hear the band the evening, because I usually arrange in the morning to like 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. 10, 12 guys. When I got there the evening, it was like 100 guys playing. And the hill was like shaking.
Mm.
You know, and I'm trying to figure out what song they're playing. You know, because I never heard it like this before. It's when as we get closer, we're like, oh, it's the same song.
It's your arrangement.
It's my arrangement. Rudolph, no one person could talk about Rudolph Charles. To me, when they talk about people that created steel drums, they talk about Spree Simon or whoever was there before Spree Simon. I think of Rudolph Charles. Without Rudolph Charles, there would be no steel drum. Even though he was the guy that created the initial thing, he was the guy that understood everything. He used to make things happen.
You understood not only, you think about just the steel pan instrument itself, but you think he understood the bigger picture as to what it would take to get it there?
He was a man among men. He was a real smart guy. He just knew how to do things. He used to make things happen. He could take, when the steel drum bands used to have little friction over the years, he used to go to any band and take anybody from any band and bring them up the hill. And the bands might have little friction going on at that time, you know. Rudolph used to say, you, I want you up the hill. Rudolph was a strange guy. But he was the one guy. I mean, there's other guys that did things, but my experience with Rudolph was genuine. I arranged for him 1 year, and I left and came up here. And he came to look for me, he didn't know I was in America. And my mother said, tears was in his eye. He said, as soon as I would find an arranger, he left and go to America. But I saw him up here a couple years later, and he said he wanted me to come back. Unfortunately, he died. But all I can think about of Rudolph Charles is he was good for pan. He understood pan, he understood people, he was political, you know.
Business-oriented, you think, as well?
He was everything. He was everything. He was everything. He was the one giant of a man, you know. And so I will always remember that. And I think that's why sometimes when I'm doing steel drum, I think of Rudolph too, you know. Because he couldn't believe what I did that year. The song that we came second with, he had liked the other song, which I did a short dance version, 67. He thought we should go on with that. It was a short version, it was awesome. But he made me feel good too. I mean, you know, he's telling me, you have that strange look. That's what he's telling me. I have that strange look. He said, all great men have that strange look. Whatever that meant, you know, whatever that meant, it was. But he really, there's a lot of guys, he opened up the eyes, you know.
I guess that he recognized the genius in a lot of people. He did.
He gave me a chance to do something that I'd never thought of, you know. And I like arranging for steel drum bands because, you know, it's the one time when you get 100 people together. Anytime you get 100 people together, it's not too bad. And you're the arranger. You know, it's like, wow. You know, it's, I mean, but it's not great, but the feeling.
The experiences.
Yes. You know, you know, when you go by a pan side, you've been there. Why are these people playing in this band and going through all of this and for nothing? Literally. At least the arrangers get paid. So to me, when you're reading for a steel drum band, it's like you get a chance to be a king for a couple of weeks. So you're going to make them, you know, sound good. So you feel like responsible for that type of thing. You know? So it is a good thing. But God bless Rudolph. He's a good man. He was a good man. Without him, band would be still in Trinidad.
When Steel Talks has been very, very pleased to have you here. Mm-hmm. Skip, as you also know, Mr. Scipio Sargeant, it's been good. Mm-hmm. And wish you all the best. Looking forward to hearing great things about your Strings and Things at Christmas CD album.
Yeah, I hope so too. It was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much.